Okay, so welcome back to the lecture on state space identification. In the previous lecture, we were introduced to the concepts of observability and Kalman filtering, and we also obtained a preview of what subspace identification algorithms can do for us. In this lecture, what we are going to do is, we are going to go into the full details of the subspace ID algorithms. However, we'll start with the simpler case where we'll assume that the impulse response data is available and that there is no noise in this data, and then gradually build on that, where the target is to reach the scenario in which the data to an arbitrary input, or that is the response to an arbitrary input, is available and that the data is corrupted with noise. Towards the end, we will talk of structured state space identification as well, very briefly. So, let us start off by recapping some of the concepts of Kalman filtering. As we have learnt, Kalman filter is a predictor corrector algorithm. It predicts the next state based on the guess of the state at this instant, and then makes a correction which we call as a filtered estimate once the new measurement is available. So, this is a schematic that we discussed yesterday in the previous lecture at length. As I had said, the Kalman gain, which denotes how much importance has to be given to the correction, depends on two things: the error or the confidence that we have in the prior estimate, and the error or the confidence that we have in the measurement, right. So, depending on the relative ratio, you would have the Kalman gain taking small or large values, right. But always when Kalman gain is small, it means that I am giving less importance to the measurement, and if it is large, of course, I am placing more importance to the measurement that I have. And the prediction error, which is yk minus c x hat minus k at the optimum, is known as the innovation. This is a term that we have seen earlier also when we were discussing time series modeling. And what this means is that the optimum prediction has been obtained through this c x hat minus k. Whatever we have left out is ek. This is a property of the Kalman filter. Not every filter will give you necessarily this, right. So, that is important, and that should be also expected because it is a minimum mean square error estimator. And we will, based on this understanding or and this term called innovation, we will shortly come across this innovations form of state space description that I briefly talked about in the previous lecture, right. And this is the point here of Kalman gain steadying out to a fixed value is something that I had broached on in the previous lecture, that for LTI systems, if you give sufficiently long time, then the Kalman gain steadies out to a fixed value. So, typically what is done is this fixed value itself is determined upfront and implemented right from step 1, because it is anyway going to steady out. And there are versions, of course, where a time varying Kalman filter gain is implemented initially and then the steady one is implemented. What is important is to remember that this Kalman filter has been derived under certain assumptions, which is that the system is LTI, that is, the deterministic part is LTI, the stochastic part is stationary, and that the noise follows a Gaussian distribution. If any of this is violated, then the Kalman filter can still be implemented, but will no longer give us optimal estimates. And of course, given that the Kalman filter was proposed more than 50 years ago, there have been numerous variants and numerous applications as well of the Kalman filter and the variants. So, you have, for example, if the system is nonlinear, there is a version called the extended Kalman filter known as the EKF. And then there is a version called uncentered Kalman filter to handle non-Gaussian Gaussianities and non-linearities in the deterministic process, non-Gaussianities in the stochastic process, details of which are provided in the textbook. So, let us quickly look at what is this innovations form. And also, I just wanted to add that there is a worked out example of the Kalman filter in the textbook. I would like you to refer to that example. We will move on and we will talk about this innovations form. this innovations form of state space description is an alternative way of describing the general state space description that we have seen earlier. The general state space description is something that we have seen in the previous lecture. This is the most general one, and these are the covariance matrices. Now, we know, at least from our discussion on subspace identification algorithms, that ultimately when I estimate a state space model, the states that I have from the model are going to be optimal states, optimally estimated ones, and they are nothing but Kalman states essentially. Therefore, it may be nice to write this state space form in the form of in terms of this optimal estimates itself, and that is the motivation for going towards the innovations form. So, what you do is you in order to derive this innovations form, you go to this equation and start asking. So, for example, here you look at this equation. This equation, in fact, the prediction comes from the state equation. So, the starting point for innovations form is this state equation itself. Instead of calling this now as x hat minus, we revert to the more familiar notation, where we write x hat of k plus 1. So, for example, you would write x hat of k plus 1 given k as, in fact, sorry, here since everything is in terms of k, we will write it in k first. So, x hat of k given k minus 1 is a x k minus 1, but we will replace now with the hats. When although we say here, you know, x k minus 1, say actually if you observe it is x hat k minus 1. So, this is k minus 1 given k minus 1, remember x hat of k minus 1 given k minus 1. Plus b u k minus 1. So, this forms the state equation for us. In fact, let me now write the equation in terms of x hat k plus 1 given k. So, let us write it that way. A x hat of k given k plus b u k, that is it, right? This is what we have. Now, x hat k given k has also, if you go back, there is a filtered estimate, that is, there is an update equation that we have here, right, where it says x hat of k given k is x hat of k given k minus 1 plus this Kalman gain times y k minus c x hat minus k. So, let us use that and write the update equation. So, we can write here x hat of k given k is x hat of k given k minus 1 plus, what do we have from the update equation? What does it say here? K times y k minus. So, for now we will drop the time varying index there on the Kalman gain. So, it is k times y k minus c, what do we have? X hat minus k, right? And then of course, we have plus b u k. Now, with the innovations, with the introductions of the innovations, we know that this term here, what is this? This is e k, right? We have already said that the optimal estimates are such that this is white noise. So, we write here a x hat of k given k minus 1 plus b u k plus k times what do you get here? A k times e k. And I am tempted to ask, is everything okay? Too many k's here. X hat of k. So, a times x hat of k given k minus 1 plus b u k plus a k times e k. So, that completes the state equation for us. X hat of k plus 1 given k is this. And then what about the output equation? What do we write? How do we write the output equation? Any ideas? It should be pretty straightforward. It's there on the screen. The answer is on the screen. Anybody?
Y of k equals C x hat.
Y of k equals?
C x hat minus k.
Which is C x hat k given k minus 1. Plus E k, that is all. Is there a difficulty? Why was there so much silence? So, that is your state space model now, where the states are Kalman states or, you know, optimally estimated states. So, if you were to work with a state space model such as this one, where let us say A, B and K, C are all given and you are given the variance of E, K and an initial condition is given, the states that you will be generating are nothing but the Kalman states, that means optimally estimated states. This is essentially your innovations form. Alright. So, we will denote this AK if you want with K prime. So, let us get back to the discussion here. So, that is what I have done and I have brought back the dependency of Kalman gain on time here. Is it clear? So, this is a much more easier form to work with because now this K has a lot of this K has a straight interpretation that it is a Kalman K. And by the way, we have derived this assuming that the state and process noise are uncorrelated. Why did I say that? Because the Kalman equations that we have used assume that process and noise are uncorrelated. If they are not, then you can also bring that into picture. But the essential form of innovations form will structure of the innovations form will remain more or less the same. The nice thing here is for the output error model, now let me ask you, for the output error model, what is K prime? That is, if you are looking at multivariate output error model and you want to write an innovations form for that structure model, what would be K prime? What does output error model assume? What is the assumption in that structure that there is about the process and measurement noise? What does output error working with output error model tantamount to? Okay, then which noise is unpredictable? So, you are still in the transfer function domain. If you recall the previous lecture, we talked, we interpreted the output error model in the state space domain, right? What did we say about the assumptions on process and measurement noise? You must recall the previous lecture. Correct. So, we have said Wx is 0, there is no process noise, right? I know the institute calendar said 26th was the last working day in the previous calendar. Apparently, I have updated it. So, you are still expected to keep your mind alert and switched on. What is the confusion, Puranan? So, in the output error model, the process noise is absent, which means for an output error model, K prime is 0, right? So, for an OE model, K prime is 0. Or of course, I can put a subscript here, does not matter. So, that you the process noise is missing and the measurement noise is only present in the white noise is present only in the measurement equation. And likewise, you can derive the structure of K for other structure, the form of this innovations form for other model structures such as Rmax, Bj and so on and even arcs. Now, as far as the difference between estimating the state space form in the original one that we have seen and the innovation form here, is that the objects of interest are different, but they are modeling the same process. In the original state equation, we were interested in A, B, C, D, Q and R, right? Noise covariances, process and measurement noises. So, here of course, D is missing, you can always add a D, that we have anyway omitted assuming one delay. In the innovations form, the objects of interest are A, B, C, D and what else? K. So, I am going to estimate the Kalman gain also from data now, that is where we are heading. Now, until now what we have learnt is that the Kalman gain is computed given the model and the noise covariance matrices. But now we have only data, we do not have any model. So, we are supposed to estimate A, B, C, D, the Kalman gain and the noise variance of Ek, covariance of Ek. Ek, remember, is a vector of white noise sequence. So, we have not escaped the burden of identification, but we have made it simpler and more interpretable, that is all. Alright. And remember that the Kalman gain itself implicitly is a function of A, B, C, D and the original noise covariances Q and R. But the dependency is so complicated that we do not even want to highlight it. We want to consider K itself as a separate entity to be, or separate quantity to be estimated, right. So, you should remember that Kalman gain is a function of A, B, C, D, Q and R. And then there is also a prior covariance matrix and so on, but this is essentially the dependency of Kalman gain. It is too complicated, so we just do not worry about it. We just say that it is yet another thing to be identified. Okay. So, with that innovations form in mind, we will march ahead towards subspace identification. Already we have learned the concepts of observability, controllability and now the Kalman filter and the innovations form. The main objective of course is the in state subspace identification, I should say, not necessarily state space, is the development of the innovations form given input output data. And the entire effort consists of, you can say, you can break down the objectives into smaller ones. The first thing is to determine the order, how many states, what is the dimension of A. If I am saying, if I am interested in estimating A, B, C, D, first I should know what the dimensions are. And those dimensions are dictated by the order. I already know the number of outputs and inputs, right. And then the estimation of A, B, C, D, depending on the method that you choose to work with, the method may either first estimate the system matrices and then the states or vice versa. There is one class of methods that estimates the states and then estimates A, B, C, D, that is also done. And then finally, the determination of Kalman gain and noise covariance matrices. So, what I intend to do in the rest of this lecture is to talk about these two mainly, and I will not be spending time on how to determine the Kalman gain and noise covariance matrices, because they are less complicated and relatively more straightforward once these two items are resolved. So, I would like you to refer to the textbook for the determination of Kalman gain and noise covariance matrices. They are much more simpler, because once you get, for example, A, B, C, D, then it is all a matter of generating the residuals and then finding the Kalman gain and noise covariance matrices. Okay. The core of any method, whether broadly speaking, there are three classes of methods that you encounter in subspace ID. One is called the enforced, and the second one is called the MOESP, and then the third one is the canonical variate analysis called the CVA. Although the names are different, the core idea is the same, which is first you construct the so-called extended observability matrix and get the order. After that, their tracks are different. One method estimates the state space matrices, focuses on getting your A, B, C, D and K, first A, B, C, D and then the states and so on. The other method says, no, I will estimate states first and then estimate A, B, C, D and so on, depending on the situation. And then there is also another variation that we will learn later on, which will lead to this CVA, but as I said, the core is all the same. So, let us understand the core problem, how it is solved. As I said, the key step in subspace ID is estimation of extended observability matrix. So, we will spend some time on understanding this extended observability matrix and then again also go through what is known as a realization based method, put together everything and then we will understand fully how the subspace ID algorithms work. Now, in that process at some point in time we will learn how an A and C are estimated from the extended observability matrix. Remember, the extended observability matrix will give us two things. One, its rank will give me the order. Two, I will be able to estimate the state matrices A and C. So, what is this extended observability matrix? The extended observability matrix is nothing but a bloated regular observability matrix. For example, what if you recall from the previous lecture, we have learned that the observability matrix subscript n, which is, that is, its dimension is n by n, its rank is nothing but the order of the system, that is the number of states in the minimal realization. And if you recall, let me write the expression here for the observability matrix. What is the observability matrix that we had? Expression C, C A up to C A to the n minus 1. So, we can straight away see that the first row, assume that right now we are dealing with single input, single output systems. If you are dealing with multi output, then the first n y rows. Let us for simplicity assume that we have single output. So, the first row of O n is your C. So, straight away I know how to get, if I am given the observability matrix, let us first talk about that and then we will talk about the extended observability matrix. And then how do I determine A? What you do is you use this shift property. What is this shift property telling me? O n, in fact, this is not how it should be written, but because so fine, this is fine. So, what do we do here? We take the first n minus 1 rows and all the columns. How many columns does O n has? Right, O n has n columns. So, you should see the dimensionally there is a consistency here. So, here you have an n minus 1 by n, all right, and then this is an n by n. And what about O n 2 to n comma colon, what is the dimension of that? It is n minus 1 by n. So, dimensionally things are compatible and you simply use the shift property. Is there an issue? Sorry? There is a problem. So, that is why I said there is an issue. So, what you do is, in fact, right, So, what we can do is, we do not need to use the pseudo trans this thing. We can construct now an extended observability matrix now. So, for example, we can go to O n plus 1. So, if I stack this up, then the next element would be C A to the n, right. That is why earlier there was an issue that I had pointed out in this equation. We will correct that. So, let us now work out things again. So, you say O n plus 1 times 1 of 1 to n, the number of columns in O n plus 1 is still n only, that does not change. Remember, in O n plus 1, what has changed as compared to O n? The number of rows has increased by 1. If it is if you are dealing with a multi output system, the number of rows increases by n y. So, we will write the correct version of this equation here, 2 to n plus 1 comma colon. Now, this O n plus 1, I have written, I have used MATLAB notation here, it is not the standard notation. So here 1 is to n, 1 to n comma colon, this dimension of this matrix is n by n, and the dimension of this matrix is n by n. So matrix compatibility is obeyed, and now I can write. So instead of n here, I should have n plus 1, and there is no n minus 1, and likewise this goes to n plus 1. That is a correction that has to be made. So this O n plus 1 that we have constructed for the purpose of estimating A is an example of the extended observability matrix. Why do we call it extended? Because if the system is of order n, then O n is full rank. O n plus 1 is of rank n, right? Anyway, the maximum rank possible for O n plus 1 is n only, because you have only n columns. But you have more rows than what you can actually, what you are supposed to fill for full row rank. Sorry, so the column rank is always n, that is a max that you can get. And because for any matrix column rank and row rank are identical, if you wanted full row rank, you should have only constructed O n, but we have constructed O n plus 1. So this O n plus 1 is nothing but the extended, an example of the extended observability matrix. It is an example. There are, when you talk of extended observability matrix, it can be extended up to any point. Now in a similar way, the controllability matrix, and you may want to make the same corrections that we made here. So you want to make here Cn plus 1, this should be n plus 1, and this should be n, and this is n plus 1. So in a similar manner, you can think of an extended controllability matrix as well. Although normally we, in all the subspace identification algorithms, the extended observability matrix is the one that appears predominantly. You very rarely see the appearance of the controllability matrix, except in the early algorithms by Ho and Kalman, which we will discuss briefly, right. So the reality is that I do not have the observability matrix with me or the controllability matrix with me. What I have is data. If I am given the model, I can construct this, or if I am given the observability matrix somehow, then I can extract three things. What we have learnt is, given the observability and controllability matrices, I can extract. So given O n, or an extra, let us now replace O n with O r. R is some dimension we do not know, and C r, which is a controllability matrix of some dimension, I can estimate. We can estimate what are the things that we can infer? Order, that is the most important thing, right. I can estimate the order to A and C and 3 B from a controllability matrix. D anyway you can estimate. That is something that you should understand in the state space identification. The major challenge in state space identification is identification of A, B and C. Identifying D is very easy. Why? Because it is the first impulse response coefficient. Remember that it is a feed through term, right? It represents a feed through term. If G of 0 is 0, that means there is a unit delay and D is 0. If G 0 is not 0, then that means that is D itself. And D can always be estimated uniquely. By and large, the major challenge in subspace state space identification is that A, B, C are unknowns and X's are also unknowns. So that is what makes the problem challenging. Okay, so coming back to the discussion that we are in, we need to somehow get this extended observability matrix or the extended controllability matrix. That is the idea. Once I get that, then things become very easy. So here is our extended observability matrix. and the rank of OR is NX. Although I have written here C, CA, CA to the R minus 1, in practice I would not know the in practice. So, here when I write it, it appears that there are NX columns for OR, correct, which is equal to N, which is true. Always the number of columns in OR will be the number of columns in C, but the number of states is not necessarily equal to the of a minimal realization is not necessarily equal to the number of columns of OR when you derive it from data. When you construct this from model, yes, then it will tally, provided C, A are all drawn from the minimal realization. In practice, we will only attempt to get this, and from here we first determine the rank, and then from the rank we know that the number of columns that are actually present in C of a minimal realization. So, that is the procedure. So, the first is you obtain OR, then you compute the rank. Once you obtain the rank, then you construct a lower order approximation, the rank R version of OR, so that the number of columns of the rank R approximation of OR or version of OR will exactly equal to the number of columns of C of the minimal realization. Anyway, we will learn all of that. Likewise, one constructs an extended observability matrix and so on. Fine. So, the goal here is to get this extended observability matrix.